This is Philippians chapter 2, verses 1 through 11. Therefore, if you have any encouragement from being united with Christ, if any comfort from his love, if any common sharing in the Spirit, if any tenderness and compassion, then make my joy complete by being like-minded, having the same love, being one in spirit and of one mind. Do nothing out of selfish ambition or vain conceit. Rather, in humility, value others above yourselves, not looking to your own interests, but each of you to the interests of others. In your relationships with one another, have the same mindset as Christ Jesus, who, being in very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be used to his own advantage. Rather, he made himself nothing by taking the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness. And being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God exalted him to the highest place and gave him the name that is above every name, that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue acknowledge that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. This is the word of God for the people of God, given in love, spoken in power. You may be seated.
Well, good morning, Harpeth. My name is Josh. If we haven't met before, I'm really glad you're here. Keep your Bible or your Bible app open to Philippians chapter 2, verses 1 to 11. We're going to be talking openly and straightforwardly about what the Lord Jesus has revealed to the Apostle Paul by the power of the Holy Spirit to us. It is powerful and off the charts relevant for our lives. So we're in this series called Crazy Busy. It's a really good time of year to have an open dialogue about the hazards of living in a crazy busy world at a breakneck pace. One of the casualties of having hurry and worry overtake your heart is isolation. We cut off from each other, we disconnect, we detach, and we fly solo at our own peril. Fred Rogers, also known as Mr. Rogers, was the creator of the television show Mr. Rogers' Neighborhood. It aired from 1968 all the way until the year 2000, 895 episodes. In 1997, Mr. Rogers won the prestigious Emmy Lifetime Achievement Award. He got up and gave one of the most memorable award show speeches in entertainment history. You should YouTube this and just watch it. So here's an excerpt of what he said. He approached the podium and he said, "So many people have helped me come to this night. Some of you are here, some are far away, and some are even in heaven. All of us have special ones who have loved us into being. Would you just take, along with me, 10 seconds to think of the people who have helped you become who you are? Those who have cared about you and watched what was best in your life. 10 seconds of silence. I'll watch the time. And whomever you've been thinking about, how pleased they must be to know the difference you feel they've made." And then the cameras pan over the audience, and you see actors and actresses tearing up in just 10 seconds. I usually don't ask people to multitask when I preach, but during this sermon, if somebody crosses your mind that has loved you well and has made a profound difference in your life, I want to encourage you to write their names on your sermon outline and see how many names you can put on there. Even if you miss some blanks along the way, if you don't hear anything else, write those names down as they come to mind. And there's a reason I want to do this, and I'll tell you more at the end. So today we're continuing this Crazy Busy series. This is part 4 of 5. We're going to land the plane next week. I know it's Labor Day weekend, but if you're in town and you're physically able to be here, I hope you'll be here. We're going to end on a strong note. So the goal of this series has been to inspire and equip you to open yourself up to the peace of God through practicing Keystone habits. We all long for peace with God and the peace of God. God is the ultimate peace provider. He will not force His peace upon us. We must proactively receive it. We do that by practicing spiritual disciplines, or as we've called them, keystone habits. A keystone habit is a daily discipline that affects your entire life. If you do this one thing, this keystone habit, it will affect everything. So let's review the keystone habits we've covered so far very quickly. In part one, Bobby taught about practicing a Christian Sabbath. I had a discussion, it's actually happened several times, but last night with some friends about the differences between a Sabbath with kids and a Sabbath without kids. It's a little bit different, don't you think? Bobby talked about sleeping in and like, you know, having some quiet time outside and having friends over and then resting some more. And I was like, oh my goodness, what if you've got kids? Like, there is no rest for the weary with kids, but we have to help them learn how to turn off and rest. So what do you do? And I'm tempted to chase that rabbit for the rest of the sermon, but I'm going to restrain myself. Yeah. Part two. Bobby taught about the power of meeting with God in the Bible. Not about checking off Bible study off your list in the morning or whenever you do it, but going there with a sense of anticipation and seeking with a sincere spirit, a hungry heart, to hear from God. God has something to say, and the most direct and clear way He reveals His will is through the Word. And then part three last week, I taught about prayer. Specifically, I commended the Lord's Prayer. Luke chapter 11 is also found in Matthew 6. Beginning your day, using the Lord's Prayer as a template to begin your day. And I would love to hear stories about how these disciplines are beginning to make their way into your life. And if you're experiencing what we've been encouraging, which is opening yourself up to the peace of God. And you will not know if this works. You will not know if these solutions really work unless you try it and experiment and actually do it. As my friends in recovery say, it works if you work it. Can you say that with me? It works if you work it. It's a good thing to remember. Today I'm going to encourage you to pursue Jesus-style friendships. Jesus-style friendships. What is a Jesus-style friendship? I'm glad you asked. I'm going to tell you. A counselor recently said that there are three kinds of friends. Balcony friends, who cheer you on from a distance. Roller coaster friends, who are often unpredictable and unstable, and you never know where you stand with them, and they create drama in your life. And basement friends, who bring you down with their negative influence. A Jesus-style friend doesn't cheer you on at arm's length. They don't put you on a yo-yo and leave you wondering, and they don't bring out the worst in you with their negativity. A Jesus-style friend knows all about you and will walk with you through anything. That's worth writing down. Every word in that definition is important. A Jesus-style friend knows all about you and will walk with you through anything. These are the kinds of friendships that change our lives forever. The Holy Spirit pours power into relationships like this. Power to heal wounds and overcome adversity and break the bondage of sin. The power to grow up in the faith. Those are just a few of the spectacular rewards of engaging in Jesus-style friendships. If you do this one thing, it will affect everything. So our text for today is Philippians 2, 1 to 11. And one of my favorite things to do when I have this extended paragraph in the Bible as a way to kind of get my mind around what the Bible scholars will call authorial intent. What was the intent of the author? What was he trying to communicate? And trying to synthesize the verses and the language and the arguments and the logic together to form one statement, a summary statement that encapsulates the essence of what this particular section of Scripture is saying. And so I tried to do that. And for whatever reason, it was pretty quick and simple. Verses 1 to 11, Philippians 2, I think Paul is making one point, one big point. And here it is. Our union with Jesus should regulate our relationships with each other. By regulate, I mean inform, shape, and control. Look back at the first few verses of Philippians 2 and watch for words that reveal the results or the evidences that our union with Christ is where it needs to be. Verse 1 says, if we have any encouragement from being united with Christ, if any comfort in His love, any common sharing in the Spirit, any tenderness or compassion. If you're an underliner or a highlighter, if you've got an app, underline or highlight the words encouragement, comfort, tenderness, and compassion. Those are vitally important. Encouragement, comfort, tenderness, and compassion. When we became followers of Jesus and rose from the waters of baptism, God did some pretty incredible things for us that we could never do for ourselves. He forgave our sins. He removed our shame and condemnation. He empowered us with the Holy Spirit. He secured our place in heaven. But He also did something else that we sometimes forget about. He united us with Jesus. He forged a connection between us and Jesus that is closer than any bond we will ever have. Jesus isn't just with us. He is with us. But it's deeper. It's more personal than that. Jesus is in us. In the words of Paul in Galatians 2, I no longer live, but Christ lives in me. And so, in many ways, discipleship is learning how to live by the indwelling presence of Jesus in your life. So you would do naturally what Jesus would do if He had your life. It is possible and amazing to actually think the same thoughts that Jesus would think, because Jesus is in you and He commands your operating system. It is possible to feel the affections of Jesus, to be totally wrapped up in worship of God, refusing idol worship. It is possible to do what Jesus did, not in your own strength, but with the power of Jesus living in you. And so you are equipped and you have the horsepower you need to be the person that you've been created to be. Our union with Christ should regulate our relationships with each other. So look back at the words that you highlighted: encouragement, comfort, tenderness, compassion. How do relationships with other people work without those things? If you take those away, or if you look at the opposite of those words, the antonyms, you've got discouragement, discomfort, hardness, and apathy. Who wants to befriend a person like that? Nobody. So Paul's going to go on to say in verses 3 to 5, that our union with Jesus should lead us to embrace a certain mindset in our relationships. So listen to how he describes it. Don't do anything out of selfish ambition or vain conceit. Don't enter relationships only thinking of you. Rather, in humility, value others above yourselves. Not looking to your own interests, but each of you to the interests of others. Verse 5 is worth maybe a double underline or a different color highlight. In your relationships with each other, have the same mindset as Christ. That's the whole point of the passage. Now, I want you to imagine with me if all of us at Harpeth Christian Church took to heart that verse. If all of us resolved to have the same mindset in our relationships with each other as Jesus would have. Home group leaders, what would it be like for people to step into your group if this was the main goal? What would it feel like to be in your group? What would our reputation in town be like? When people mention Harpeth Christian Church, what would they say? What would it be like to be a first-time guest, step foot on the property, come in to a church full of people who are sold out to the idea and to the lifestyle of having the same mindset in our relationships with each other that Jesus would have? So I'm going to leave that with you. Let God take your imagination. It's pretty amazing what would happen if we all went there together. I seem to hear a lot of conversations, not just in our church, but in other venues too. It goes like this. People aren't as close as they used to be. I heard that from my dad a couple of weeks ago. I even heard that from my grandparents when they were still alive about a decade ago. And I would listen to the way they described their life growing up with open doors and people on the front porch rather than the back deck. I even heard my grandmother go off once on the terrible invention known as air conditioning. And I was like, what are you talking about? I mean, I don't know how people live without air conditioning. And she's like, yeah, but we all were outside and we were with each other and like we knew each other. And I didn't think much of it. I was just, you know, thinking like a pretentious, you know, Generation Xer. And I'm like, what? I just can't imagine life without AC. But the longer I've lived and the more I observe and the more I experience, I think she's on to something. As the world has made so-called progress, we have distanced ourselves from other people. And if you ask the secular, unbelieving world to define friendship, you get some pretty interesting and unclear answers. The New York Times recently featured an article exploring our current cultural confusion about friendship. Ask people to define friendship, even experts who research it, and you'll get some uncomfortable silence. So here's what Alexander Neiman, a professor of philosophy at Princeton, says in his latest book on friendship. Friendship is really hard to describe. He spends almost 300 pages trying to define friendship, and he can't quite do it. It's easier to say what friendship is not, and foremost, it is not strategically selfish. I think he's right about that. It's not a means to obtain higher status or wrangle an invitation to someone's vacation home or simply escape your own boredom. Rather, he says, friendship is like beauty or art. It should be appreciated for its own sake. Ronald Sharp, a professor who teaches a course on the, get this, literature of friendship, added, it's not about what someone can do for you. It's who and what the two of you can become in each other's presence. The notion of doing nothing but spending time in each other's company has, in a way, become a lost art. People are so eager to maximize efficiency of relationships that they have no clue about what it means to befriend somebody without an agenda. Efficiency of relationships, that's our culture. If you can't enhance my status and improve my life, I don't have time for you. People would rather stay home with the garage door closed than cultivate authentic friendships. Because if you want to befriend somebody for real, you have to put in and invest in three things: time, risk, and love. Real friendships require investments on both parties. Time. How are you going to get to know somebody? You got to spend time with them. Risk. You have to share some things about your own life if the connection is going to be what you hope it is, and they're going to have to share too. Mutual authenticity. And then love. You'll have to actually demonstrate that you love this person. The most natural thing to do in a teaching about friendship is to focus on other people. That's what I started doing as I was preparing the message. I was like, oh, who are my real friends? Like, who are they? Who puts in the time, the risk, and the love in my life? And I made some progress there. But then it was like the Holy Spirit said, as strongly as he possibly could, okay, stop thinking about them and let's aim that perception at yourself. So I don't know if I'm creatively plagiarizing this word. I'm like trying to figure out, where did I hear this word? I'm certain I'm not clever enough to come up with it, but I thought about this word, friendability. How friendable are you? And I started thinking about my own life, and like how if I were to rank myself, like how would I even evaluate my friendableness? And I thought this might be fun to do during the sermon on friendship. I want to give you an opportunity to assess your own friendability. By friendability, here's what I mean. How effective are you at forming and cultivating healthy, God-centered friendships? Would you agree that we're more clueless than ever about friends? I mean, you look at the social media thing and all the contacts on your phone, and I know that some people are more introverted and some are really gregarious, but I hope you agree with me on this. This has really nothing to do with personality. Everybody desires genuine friendships. And here's the other thing. The Christian life is impossible. It's not just difficult, it's impossible without other followers of Jesus that stand with you, walking with you. Our whole mission as a church, helping people trust and follow Jesus. I love that we have the word people in our mission statement. People coming together. Nobody can trust and follow Jesus without the help of Jesus-loving friends. That's why we have such an emphasis on groups, and we'll talk about groups at the end. You know, you probably saw it. If you've been around Harpeth, you're like, oh, here we go. We're going to hear yet another sales pitch on groups. Yes, you are. You absolutely are, and you need it. We all need it. Even the ones who are fully bought into their group, we need to hear this again because we tend to forget, and we as a church can experience what we call mission creep, and where we start veering a little bit off, and we have to come back to the center and remember who we are and what we're doing here. And what we're doing, in a nutshell, is helping people trust and follow Jesus in the context of Jesus-style friendships. There's no other place, there's no other environment where that happens. So here we go. Are you ready to assess your friendability? Here we go. I'm going to ask you five questions, and I'm going to say a little bit about each one. As we go through these, ask God to show you where you need to grow. Question number one, are you available? Do you have enough margin in your life to put in the time to be a real friend to somebody? I was talking to my oncologist about a month ago. We have these amazing conversations. And I was talking to him about friendships. And he told me that I was not just a a patient, but I had become a friend to him, and I was like, this is really cool, because we almost have nothing in common. And, I mean, really. And I said, what about your other friendships? He said, yeah, I don't have any other friends. And I said, do you want more friends? I was thinking that could be a really good lead into church. He didn't bite. He was like, no, I just don't get close to people. And I wanted to, like, you know, ask him some questions about that, because we're not born that way. We get there after maybe some pain and some hard life experiences, but I didn't want him to think I was psychoanalyzing him. He didn't like that. He's resistant to that stuff. So like, I'm going to let it go. And I said, so how's that working for you? And he said, actually, I think it's working pretty great. So not being close to people is working? He said, yeah, I have dogs for that. He said, dogs bring absolutely no drama into your life. And then he put me on the exam table, and then we went on from there. It was just a funny conversation. One of the harshest consequences of being crazy busy is isolation. You got to put the time in. You got to not, it's not just physical. Well, you have to show up. You do. But there's another layer of availability, and it's emotional availability. When you're with people, can you really be there with them? Available people are fully present. They are not distracted by their phones. In fact, you may never see their phones when you're with them. So yes, this hits me right between the eyes. I'm totally guilty of this. And I am pierced by this thought. Have you ever thought about how rude it is to check your phone during a conversation? My phone has hundreds of contacts, so whenever I put my phone on display during a meeting or just some time with friends, it's like I'm saying, all of these people on my phone are just as important as you are, even though they're not here. If you want to befriend somebody, look them in the eye. Ask questions out of curiosity. I'm helping you out here, okay? Out of a genuine desire to hear, understand, and connect. A fully present person, an available person, their internal speed is a little slower than the speed that our culture suggests we live at. Question 2, are you safe? When you're around a safe person, you're free from the pressure to perform. You're not constantly worried about how they're perceiving you. Who are the safe people in your life? Do you have people that you can be totally yourself with? You don't have to project a false self. You can be who you are, and they're completely fine with you. Who can you trust with anything? And know they won't overreact or judge you or think differently about you. Here's a better question. How safe are you for others? Who knows without a doubt that you're in their corner no matter what? Can your friends be around you and be themselves? Can they tell you sensitive things and know that you won't overreact or betray their confidence? Do they feel heard and understood when they're with you? If you want to be a good friend, you'll need to be safe. Question 3, are you selfless? Back to the mindset of Christ. Jesus is a servant. Our union with Jesus should compel us to serve others, especially our friends. Selfless people know the world doesn't revolve around them and their schedules and their preferences and their boundaries and their goals and their stresses and their finances and their marriage and their kids and whatever. They don't enter relationships in order to move up or get a leg up in life. They serve and bring value to others. They laugh at themselves easily. They don't take themselves too seriously. Selfless people are humble, and we don't achieve humility by pursuing humility. Humility is the fruit of living in the presence of God. Because you cannot be in the presence of God and be prideful. God will crush our pride for our own good. When I remember that He is with me and that I am never not in His presence, and that it's never just the two of us, there's always a third there. Humility is always the first reaction. If you want to be a good friend, you'll have to be selfless. Question four, are you encouraging? Oh, this is a big one. While I'm not naturally gifted as an encourager, become an encourager. Figure it out. Well, I'm more of a realist. Or I'm more grounded in reality, and that's not my personality. I don't care. Do you realize what your spouse and your kids and your neighbors and your friends and your coworkers all have in common? They need encouragement. Not just in a general sense. They need it from you. Because the way God encourages them through your voice will be unlike any form of encouragement they will ever receive. You have your own voice, your own effect that is specific to you and your hard wiring, and the only way you'll know what that feels and looks like is to open your mouth and do it. I am fascinated by the background of the word encourage. If you trace it all the way back to its origin, you'll discover that it literally means in, as in I-N, courage. When you encourage somebody else, you literally put courage in them. After spending time with an encourager, you feel more resilient and fearless. An encourager can shift your thinking from, I can't handle this, to I've got this. A simple word of encouragement can change the trajectory of somebody's entire week. Have you ever noticed that when you encourage somebody else, that you yourself feel encouraged? I think that's the voice of our Father. And He's saying, yes, this is what I've designed you to do. This is what I want for you. And that buzz of joy is from God, and He wants us to feel it, and feel it often. Anybody can encourage somebody else. Introverts and extroverts, loud people and quiet people, reserved or expressive, organized or messy, it doesn't matter. Resolve to become an encourager and watch what God does in your soul. If you want to be a good friend, you'll have to learn how to encourage people. Question five, are you transparent? This one is hands down the most important. Aside from dishonesty, because you can only love somebody as much as you trust them. Aside from dishonesty, I can't think of a more destructive friendship inhibitor than fakeness. Do you enjoy being around fake people? Real friends don't play games or project a glittering image of themselves. They are who they are. Now, there is such a thing as oversharing. You know what I'm saying? Have you ever been around an oversharer? Have you ever been in a conversation where you're like, whoa, like TMI, like this is feeling awkward, and I'm feeling like maybe you have an unmet emotional need and you want me to meet it for you and I need to back away. Okay, I'm not recommending that. There is such a thing as appropriate self-disclosure. And you've got to know when that is. And every now and then you may mess up or you may undershare. Undersharing is just as toxic, to be honest. That's why I want to challenge everybody in a group. And if you're in a discipleship group of any kind, T group, home group, learning group, sewing group, I don't care. If you're in a group and the people in your group really don't know each other and it's been a few months, something's off. Do they know who you really are? A hallmark of a Jesus-style friendship is transparency. It's essential. Transparency means not acting like you have it all together.
It's admitting your faults and talking about the struggles you face. It's showing other people your pain. In superficial relationships, everybody's always okay. We're doing fine, thank you very much. Friendships are deepened not when people are strong together, but when they're weak together. I remember hearing a great uncle talk about his experience at war. And when he talked about his comrades at arms, his bottom lip and his chin quivered, and the tears welled up and fell. And it wasn't because they were strong men together. It was because they were scared out of their minds together. And their common weakness forged an unbreakable bond between them. That, my friends, is what we must learn to do if we want to crawl out of the prison of isolation. We must learn how to be weak together, because as you know, strength is an illusion. I am not strong. God is strong. I want to be around people who will believe that with me. If you want to be a good friend to somebody, you'll have to be transparent. So did you write some names down? Back to the Mr. Rogers story, did you write some? Look at their names. Scan the five questions. The people that I wrote down, they possess all five qualities of friendability. They're available, they're safe, selfless, encouraging, and transparent. When you're in a relationship with someone like this, it changes you forever. So let's talk about next steps. What do you do with all this? I'm going to suggest three. Number one, you saw it coming. I showed you my cards, and now here they are. If you're not in a discipleship group, get in a group. I'm going to be at the information desk right outside door one. There is a listing of groups, and we are committed to not leaving this building until everybody who desires a group gets one. Don't leave here and continue flying solo. It's just not worth it. Number two, and this applies to most of us here, if you're in a group, go all in and give yourself to the group. Don't just attend the group meetings and mail it in and go back to your life. Resolve to become a Jesus-style friend. Make real connections. Put forth the effort to truly befriend people. Between now and Christmas, resolve, commit to deepening your friendships within that group. And number three, lean in to your union with Jesus. And that's the most critical of all three steps. Lean in. You are linked and connected to Jesus. Lean in. He called himself, Jesus did in John 15, a vine. And we are branches. And he said, apart from me, you can do nothing. And so the secret of life, it really is. That's a really, I know, a grandiose statement. The secret of life, the secret of the Christian life, most definitely, is staying connected to that vine and doing what my grandmother used to say, abide with Christ. I love that old word, abide. And when we abide in him, all the nutrition and strength and energy we need to love people well will be supplied by him. We can't work it up. We have to receive it from him. And so